is going on, Embrace? Welcome to church today. I'm Brian. I get to be one of the pastors here. And if you're watching online or at one of our campuses, if you're out at T or Sertoma, special welcome to you. If you're watching online, glad that you're here for all of you in the room. We don't take it for granted. We are just so glad that you're here today. It's been a while since I've been up here, so I thought I'd get a little bit of a life update about what's been going on. Last fall, I went through a midlife crisis, so I decided to become a professional pickleball player. It's now all that I talk about, and so it's just Jesus and pickleball. And if I'm honest, sometimes it's pickleball than Jesus. And so we're going to get into that today, actually. Here's what I've learned. I've learned on Instagram, you can become a big deal and become a pickleball influencer. I don't want to brag or anything, but I'm kind of a big deal there. The people that are not impressed are my family. They are not impressed even a little. I want to show you this picture. This is my pickleball partner, Nate. We were getting ready to play like a championship match. Would you notice what his wife is doing for him? She's giving him a back rub, preparing. I sent this picture to my wife and I'm like, Andrea, where are you? And she's like, what are you doing today? I'm like, I'm at a pickleball tournament. How do you not know this? And so she is very unimpressed, but that's essentially become most of my personality. It's all pickleball related. I'm not really sure why the midlife crisis happened. On an unrelated note, we sent our oldest to college and now I cry myself to sleep every night. So I don't know what that has to do with anything. Thanks for being here. We are in our Weird Stuff Christians Do series. And the idea behind this series is that we would talk about some things that those of us as Christians, we do maybe inside these walls, outside these walls, but the rest of the world looks at and is like, that's kind of weird. I don't understand why they do that. And so one of the things we hit a few weeks back was we talked about reading our Bible. Why do we read the Bible, this 2,000-year-old book? Like, why? That's kind of weird. Adam, a few weeks back, talked about why we sing together as a church. Like we all get together like we just did. We sing songs together. That's a little bit weird. Today, we're going to talk about, okay, why is it that Christians don't always act or live the way that Jesus does? Why don't Christians always act or live the way that Christians or the way that Jesus did? And this is strange. We get our term Christian from Jesus Christ, Christ Christian. We say, hey, we're followers of Jesus, but there are many times where our actions don't live up to that. And the way that we call, what we say about this or how we call this is we act like hypocrites. When we don't live or act like Jesus did, we act like hypocrites. And in our society, there's a big trust problem with the church, with Christians. In fact, the Barna Group did a survey recently, and 85% of the people that responded to this survey said that they think Christians are hypocritical, that they live in a way that they don't believe. And so the irony of this subject is that Jesus was really harsh on hypocrites. He was really harsh in what he had to say. And so do we, as Christians, do we need to actually wrestle with this idea that sometimes we don't act or live the way that Jesus does? And I think we do. In fact, like I said before, Jesus had a lot of harsh things to say about hypocrites. Notice in Matthew 23, he says this, "Woe to you, teachers of the law and Pharisees, you hypocrites, you are like whitewashed tombs, which look beautiful on the outside, but on the inside are full of bones of the dead and everything unclean. In the same way, on the outside, you appear to people as righteous, but on the inside, you are full of hypocrisy and wickedness." These are strong words. So first, who are the Pharisees? The Pharisees are the religious leaders of the day. You would say, yeah, they're the kind of the pastors. And so anytime Jesus talks about the religious leaders, the teachers of the law and the Pharisees, my ears perk up. I know he's talking to me. But here's the deal for you. If you don't work at a church, you don't get off the hook with this verse. If you are a Christian, if you are serious about your faith, if you'd say, yeah, I follow Jesus, anytime Jesus talks to the Pharisees or talks to the teachers of the law, he is talking to you just as much as he's talking to me. And Jesus, in this passage, he uses kind of really interesting imagery. He says, essentially, he's saying, hey, you, teachers of the law, you, Christian, you, follower of Jesus, oftentimes are like a well-kept gravestone. A well-kept gravestone that on the outside, it looks clean, it's polished, it's even something to be admired, but that's just the outside. On the inside, it is full of the bones of the dead and everything unclean. And Jesus is saying that's what hypocrisy looks like. When you say or profess one thing, but you do another thing, you're like a grave that has a headstone and on the outside looks good, but on the inside is full of death. You see, these words are not just for me, they're for all of us as Christians. And according to Jesus, when we do one thing, when we say one thing and we do the other, we are unclean and filled with everything unclean. The interesting thing about hypocrisy is this is not just for the church. We see hypocrisy in politics, in Hollywood. We see politics in the financial world, in relationships. And if we're honest, if we have any self-awareness at all, I think all of us in this room, me included, could look at a time where we acted in a way that we don't support. Like we did something opposite to what we believe. And so here's what I want to do today. I don't want to talk about the hypocrisy of the world. I don't want to talk about hypocrisy of other people. I want to dig into this. If 85% of people think Christians are hypocrites, there must be some truth to that, at least the view of it. And if that's the case, why is there hypocrisy in us, in Christians who should know better, right? So I want to look at two ways why there's hypocrisy in us. And then I want to finish with how do we fight that? How do we combat that hypocrisy? So this isn't an exhaustive list, but I think these two things that we're going to look at are kind of building blocks for why there's hypocrisy in the church. The first one is we know his story, but we don't know him. We know his story, but we don't know him. What if I told you the scariest passage in the Bible is not directed at somebody who's living wildly? It is directed at the Christian. It is directed at the churchgoer. The scariest passage in the Bible is smack dab pointed at me and at you. And here's what it says. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only the one who does the will of the Father who is in heaven. Many will say to me on that day, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name? And in your name, did we not drive out demons and in your name perform many miracles? Then this is Jesus responding. Then I will tell them plainly, I never knew you. Away from me, you evil doers. See, Jesus is talking to a group of people here that know him, but he doesn't know them in return. And what Jesus is essentially saying here is that we are to know him, not just know about him. We are to know Jesus, not just know about Jesus. The truth is, in this world, there's plenty of us who say that we follow Jesus, that we know him, but we've just heard a story or two. We're following somebody else's version of Jesus. And he makes it very clear in this passage that not everyone that knows him, he knows. Not everyone that knows Jesus is known by Jesus. A couple years back, this is about 2 years ago, I went on a bachelor party weekend. I know what you're thinking. That guy's in his 40s. Why is he still going on bachelor parties? I was wondering the same thing. Here's the deal. For a guy's weekend away, when you're in your 20s, you're like, let's do it. I don't care what we're doing. Let's go. I'll play 800 holes of golf and it's going to be great. When you're in your 40s, all I want to do is mow my lawn on a Saturday and take a nap. And so I was very skeptical about this guy's weekend away. But six of us, I took one for the team, and six of us headed to Breckenridge, Colorado. And these were all Embrace Church guys, four of us on staff, two other guys from our T campus. And we called ourselves the Wolf Pack because we're cool like that. We were just going to have a great time. We didn't overly plan out our time together. We thought we're going to do some whitewater rafting. We're going to hit a couple good restaurants. And we wanted to go on at least one legit hike, like one good hike. And so we're not wilderness survivalists by any means, but we know our way around a map. Check out this video.
Just Jason's boys.
Jason's boys.
Get a howl for the video.
Nerds.
Let's hope there's nobody else on this trail. McCullough Gulch Trail, we just started.
Okay, so that is my voice. If everything was going great. That video is at 8:46 in the morning, and we're on McCullough Gulch Trail, and we're having the time of our lives. The next video is at 9:12, 26 minutes later.
Brian, where are you
here in the backwoods of Colorado. Took us all of about 30 minutes to get completely lost in the woods. We're all here, having a great time. How much time do you think it was?
14 minutes.
About 14 minutes to get lost in the woods of Colorado. We're doing our best. If you're seeing this video, then that means that we made it out of the woods and I was able to send it somewhere. So be very thankful if you find this video or see this video. I'm terrified. Jason's had to drink his pee twice already, just to ration water. Yeah, like I said, it's only been 14 minutes.
If I die.
Things got out of hand quickly. We were so lost. This is no joke. We were lost instantly. And ultimately, we did find our way back. I don't want to show you the 3 hours of video that it took to get us back, but I do want to show you the route that we took. Check this out.
All right, so we're just going to get this video. This is the trail that we took. It was just straight up the mountain, literally straight up. A little difficult. You can see the red, red, orange, all those colors. I mean, it's really difficult. Then you're going to reach a point here, just a bit, where we were officially in 100% lost. Just absolutely lost. Had no idea where we were. I think all of us were silently very worried in our heads. But we slowly made our way back. We followed the river. We followed the sound of the river to finally...
We were lost. I cannot tell you how lost we were. There was a time that I walked past and I'm like, that looks like really fresh bear poop. He is around here somewhere. I thought we were going to die, but we got out. The last video I have for you is maybe the way we should have gone.
So here's the sign. McCullough Gulch Trailhead. Here's the directions. There we are. Walk out. On that road, and then there's the road.
There's the road.
And then the trailhead's just beyond that. We just came that way. But we decided to be like, you know what? Let's start over here. That's where we started. I love it.
So the trail started over here, and we started back there. We were never on the right trail. We at no point were we on McCullough Gulch Trail. We were lost instantly, and here's the point. For some of us, we need to know Jesus, not just know about him. We knew about the trail. People had told us about this hike, but we'd never been on it. Nobody had ever taken us to it. We'd never seen it. And so we knew about it, but we didn't know it. And so we were lost instantly. And so for us as Christians, I think this can happen to us where we say, yes, I am a follower of Jesus. That is who I am. But really, you're following somebody else's idea of Jesus. You have actually met him. And we're not necessarily being hypocrites because we want to. We're being hypocrites because we think we're on the right path. But we've never even seen the right path. And so for Jesus, this is really key. Like he's leaning into this with his disciples, with the people around him. He wants people to be really sure that they understand that it's not simply enough to know him. It's interesting because we can just do all the right things as Christians. We can do all the right things as churchgoers. We can check all of the right boxes. But if we don't know Jesus, we're going to follow something that we think is like following Jesus. And so if I didn't know Jesus, if I had just heard about Jesus, maybe one of the ways that I would try to follow Jesus is I would defend my political party at all costs. And I would say, yeah, that's following Jesus. I'm not sure you've met him. You've heard about him. Or maybe, just maybe, you see other people, and I have done this. When I say you, I'm talking to me as much as I'm talking to you. When we see other people that are living in ways that we would not live, and we attack them, and we go after them, and we're like, well, this is what we're supposed to do. We're supposed to hold the line on morality. It is right here. We got to hold this line. And those people have never said they were Christians. And so we assume attacking them is what it means to follow Jesus. And I would say, I'm not sure you've met Jesus. I think you've heard about him. And so one of the big keys here for us in the church is, how do we root out hypocrisy in our lives? How do we do that? We actually get to know him. We don't just know about him. I talked to a local therapist this week about hypocrisy, and it might be surprising to find out he had a lot to say. He deals with a lot of people that bring in stories, and he's like, here's where hypocrisy can be born out of. It can be born out of you following a rule that is not your rule. It's somebody else's rule. Trying to follow a rule that you've been told it's the right thing to follow, but it's someone else's, it's not yours. You don't really believe it. And so for us in the church, it might be true that we've heard of Jesus, that we know about him, but we've actually never met him. And that can lead to hypocrisy. The second reason that I think there's hypocrisy in the church is this: we know him, but we don't trust him. We know him, but we don't trust him. Look at what Paul, the author of Romans, says. I do not understand what I do. For what I want to do, I do not do. But what I hate, I do. For I have the desire to do what is good, but I cannot carry it out. For I do not do the good I want to do, but the evil I do not want to do, this I keep doing. Paul is wrestling here. He's wrestling with his own actions. He's like, why do I always do the thing I hate? Why do I always do the thing I don't want to do? I know what I want to do, and yet I'm conflicted. I do the thing that I hate. Maybe it's the path of least resistance. Maybe it feels good for a moment, but ultimately Paul understands this. In our own spirit, we are battling to try to do the good that we want to do, but oftentimes we choose what we hate. And for us as Christians, the dirty little secret is we are not perfect. Even when we follow Jesus, we are going to still mess up. We are still going to sin. We are still going to have mistakes in our life. And oftentimes for Christians, we don't fall into sin. We leap willingly into the arms of sin. And so this might look different for people. It might be something small like, hey, I'm going to put a little more on this sales invoice and see if the client notices. I'm going to pull up my phone and I'm going to scroll through a bunch of pictures that I know I shouldn't look at, and they're going to get stuck in my head for the rest of the day. Maybe it looks like lashing out in anger at the one who loves you best. The question isn't if we're going to mess up, if we're going to make a mistake. The question is, what do you do when you mess up? What comes next? What is next for you after you do the thing that you hate? And if you do not trust Jesus with these moments, if we don't trust Jesus with these mistakes, we will become the hypocrite out of fear, because we know better. And we're certain, man, I've messed up. I knew I shouldn't have done this. I've messed up. I can't come back from this. There's no way Jesus would forgive this. And so the problem isn't that we make a mistake. The problem is that we don't know what to do with it after we make a mistake, because the Christian is supposed to know better. So what do? We hide. But notice what 1 John says here. He says, if we admit our sins, simply come clean about them, he won't let us down. He'll be true to himself. He'll forgive us our sins and purge us from all wrongdoing. And my question to you today is this: do you trust Jesus? Do you trust him enough to give him your worst mistake? To confess your most humiliating moment? Do you trust him with your darkest secret? If not, we become hypocrites and live in a way that we don't believe. And I can speak to this kind of hypocrite because this is me. I can speak to this hypocrite because I'm the one who hides. When I make a mistake, I don't make a mistake because I didn't know better. I absolutely knew better, and I still make a mistake. And what do at that moment? I hide. I pretend. I cover up. I don't want anyone to see me, because here's what I think. I think if you actually knew me, if you actually knew my thoughts, I think if you actually knew how I've wounded my wife, how I've been a poor father at times, if you knew my greatest mistakes, I'm not sure you would accept me. Not just Jesus, I'm not sure you would. And so I hide because I'm ashamed. And that is what we do as Christians. We hide. We know Jesus, but we don't trust him in that moment. 15 years ago, I sat on a living room couch looking my wife dead in the eyes and saying, we don't have any money left. I had made bad financial decisions, not like one big financial decision, not like I'd spent it all gambling or something like that in one night. I had made a bunch of decisions that I knew exactly what I was doing, and I had done nothing to fix them. And I had to tell her that I've hidden this all from you. And I was certain she wasn't going to accept me in that. And why did I hide? I hid because I don't trust Jesus. In that moment, I hadn't trusted Jesus. I knew him, but I was too afraid of my mistake. I was too ashamed of my mistake. So I wasn't a hypocrite because I thought I knew better. I was a hypocrite because I had sinned, because I'm freaking human and we all sin. But then after that, it's about the cover up. It's not that, are you going to sin or not? It's what do you do after that moment? Going back to 1 John, Jesus, he's saying this. He says, Jesus will be true to himself. He will forgive us our sins and he will purge us from all wrongdoing. This is remarkable that he's willing to do this. Jesus will purge the wrongdoing from us. And he will forgive us. And if I trusted that, if I actually trusted that, I would have come forward a lot sooner. A lot sooner. So, thanks, Pastor. We're all hypocrites. Great service. See you next week, right? Like, can't wait to come back next week. What are you going to tell me next week? Okay. The question isn't whether we have hypocrisy in the church. The question is, what do we do with it? And how do we combat it? How do we combat our own sin in our lives? And I've got a couple things for us. The first is this, get to know Jesus. It's the most simple. Get to know Jesus. Don't know about him. Don't ask someone else about him. Get to know him. Get in God's word. When you read particularly the gospels and you see how Jesus interacts with people, you see how he loves people. You get to know him in a way that you cannot from someone else telling you about Jesus. Get to know him. Get around other people that are doing the same. It matters to have other people cheering you on in the faith. You've got to get to know him. Without that, we're all going to be hypocrites. Spend time in God's word. Get in a group. When you come to Jesus with an open heart, there is no way he will turn away from you. That is not in his character. That is not a thing that Jesus does. And so get to know him. And for those of you that know Jesus but don't trust him, we've actually maybe got more work to do. And I've got a diagram to show this. The first thing that we need to do, if we don't trust Jesus, to start trusting him, we have to confess. We have to come to him and say, hey, God, there's something in me that I have been battling, I've been fighting, and I can't deal with it anymore. It is yours. You have to confess to Jesus. There's someone in this room, there's someone watching online right now, and you are hiding. You are hiding something. I don't know what it is, but I know what it's like to be the one hiding something. And you've made a bunch of promises to yourself, haven't you? Say, you know what? This is the last time. This is the last time I compromise. God, take this from me. This is the last time. This is the last time I cheat. This is the last time I have a drink. You got to confess that to God. But the next step is you have to take action. You got to do something about it. And for most of us, this is probably telling someone else. This is letting someone else in and telling them, hey, not only have I wronged God and not only have I sinned against you, I've sinned against someone else. You need to tell somebody. This will not be easy. You're going to deal with the fear that I dealt with, that I don't know if they're going to accept me. And if we're honest, we have to understand that they actually have a choice in that. They can actually choose not to accept us. Sometimes when we take action and we confess to someone else, it doesn't go well. That doesn't mean it's the wrong thing to do. Because if you do not, the other option is just to stay where you've been. So first confess to God. then confess to someone else. Tell them what you're dealing with. Tell them what you're struggling with. Those are the two things you need to do. Here's the two things you're going to want to do. You're going to want to conceal. What was it Elsa said? Conceal, don't feel. That's what you're going to want to do. It didn't work for Elsa. It's not going to work for you. When we conceal, when we hide, man, whatever it is we're hiding stays in the dark. And the enemy wants you in the dark. He wants your mind in the dark. He wants your actions in the dark. He wants you to think that your shame is so great that it cannot be overcome by the King of the universe. And that's a freaking lie from the pit of hell. But you're going to want to conceal. The opposite of confession is concealment. And rather than action, what you're going to want to do is you're going to want to have apathy. You're going to want to do nothing. And the interesting thing about this diagram is we could be at any point on this diagram. You could actually take action on something, but still hide, be hiding something. You could be on the lower right there. You could confess to God, even confess to another person, and do nothing. You could be there as well. My prayer is that for all of us, we're up and to the right on this scale, not because we love to deal with hard things, but because without that, there's no growth. Without that, we are doomed to be hypocrites. I want to finish with this. A couple months ago, I started going to the gym. You can probably tell. I have been scared all my life to go to the gym because I was certain when I walked into the gym, everyone would look at me and be like, why is he here? And here's what I learned when I went to the gym. Nobody cares. Nobody's looking at you. I'm looking at everybody because I didn't know how to work any of the machines. So I was looking. But here's the deal. When I went into the gym, this is what I learned. I learned there was a lot of people there that were really healthy. They were ripped. You can tell they've been consistent. They've been doing it for a long time. And then the other group of people there are me and others that are even less healthier than me, less healthy than me. And if we treated the gym like the world treats the church, we'd be like, why is that unhealthy person at the gym? What are they doing there? The point is the gym exists for a person to get healthy. Just like that, the church is built for hypocrites. It is built for people who mess up. We come to church not because we want to sustain our hypocrisy, but because we want to fight it. Because we want to be better, not because we're so great, but because there's a God who loves us and said, I will do anything for you and I will prove it on the cross. The question is not, are there hypocrites in church? The question is, what do we hypocrites do when we fail? Get to know Jesus. Not just get to know him, but know that you can trust him. And he will give you everything you need. He will give you purpose. He will give you vision. He will give you peace and contentment. All the things the world says it can give you and actually can't offer. You do that. And then this is a group of hypocrites that I want to be around. Let's pray. God, we love you. I'm so thankful for each and every person in this room and online. Father, I know we're hiding. Not only do I know it, you know it. You know we're hiding. Would you give us the faith and the strength to come to you with courage and to confess to you what we're hiding? Would you give us the courage to tell someone else and get that person in the game with you, in the fight with you? Father, I pray for that person here. They've been battling something, and today's the day. Today's the day that they're going to say what it is. Today's the day they're going to come clean. God, would you give them a comfort right now? Let them know that they're loved by the King. Let them know that there is no shame in confession. Let them know that there is nothing too big that is outside of your love and your redemption. God, make us more like you. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Hey everyone, it's Adam from Embrace. If you enjoyed today's message, make sure to subscribe to Embrace's YouTube channel to stay updated. You can also click here to check out other videos. Thanks for watching.